Well, good evening, everyone. Welcome to our first Storytellers Night here at Beneva Christian. We have four storytellers plus me that we're going to be telling stories tonight. And I was thinking about how to kind of kick this off and start. Oh, by the way, for everyone telling a story tonight, there's a little X on the carpet right here. So stand on the X so you're right here by the microphone. We are recording tonight, so we'll have this saved for posterity for all you storytellers. So please show the love, and when something's funny, laugh really loud so it could be on the recording. Thinking about everything that's going on in the world right now, we think about what's happening over in Israel. We think about, you know, the things that are going on right here in this country. We think about the things that are going on in our lives, and sometimes we get overwhelmed by them. And today I was doing one of the things that I usually do when I'm like having a snack or something like that, and I have some downtime. I put on a TED Talk. And one of the TED Talks was saying, not about this specific situation, but about life, is that there's so much beyond our control. There's so much that we can't do anything about. But what we can do about is live our life to the fullest. In the midst of everything, to, as the poet once said, suck the very marrow out of life, you know, to enjoy life and to get the most out of it. And tonight, that's what this is about. This is about people sharing pieces of their hearts, pieces of their lives. Some of the stories are going to make you tear up, and some of the stories might make you laugh a little bit. Hopefully, all of the stories will make you think in some way, shape, or form. So without further ado, let's have a word of prayer. Oh, gracious Lord, as we gather here tonight, we understand that there's so many things happening in Israel. There's so many things happening right down the street. There's so many things happening beyond our control. And so, Lord, we turn everything over to you. We thank you for the freedom and the ability to come together tonight and to share stories and to be together. And we pray for all of those people who find themselves around this world that can't do this very thing tonight. There's not freedom to do that. There's not the ability to do that. They can't gather. They can't be with their loved ones. They can't be with their families. And Lord, we lift them up to you tonight. And Lord, we pray for our storytellers. For Lord, we know it takes a lot of guts to stand up in front of people and tell a story about your life. And so, Lord, I pray that your spirit would be present in this place, that you would encourage each one of our storytellers so they can in turn encourage us. And so, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for this night. We thank you for this opportunity. We pray it in the name of Jesus. Amen. So to kick it off, I'm going to play a little game with you. It's that game of two truths and a lie. Anybody ever played that game before? And that's where someone shares three things with you, and you have to determine which one is true and which one is the lie. One of the things will be a lie. So I'm going to tell you a story. And this story that I'm going to tell you is totally true, except for one thing. But I'm not going to tell you what that one thing is. That's for you to figure out. It was 1978. I was 13 years old, living in Crown Point, Indiana. And this was a big summer for me, because at the age of 13, my parents gave me the ability to ride my bike to the Lake County Fair. And the Lake County Fair was on the other side of Crown Point from where I lived, about a half hour bike ride. And so we were very excited about this opportunity to go to the fair without being shackled by our parents. We were free. And so our friends and I got together, and we rode our bikes across town on Monday, the first day of the fair. And my sister was an English jumper. She had a horse, and she always competed in the fair. And so I had a special pass that could get us down to the stables. And so we were able to go down to the stables and park our bikes there so they would be out of harm's way. No one would steal them down by the stables. And so we put our bikes down by the stables and we made our way up to the Midway. And of course at the Midway, there's games and rides and food, and it's a whole bunch of fun. And I'd been saving my allowance for so long to get ready for this Lake County Fair because I was able to go by myself. Well, my allowance lasted about a day. On Monday, when I was riding home, I realized that I wanted to go back to the fair the next day, but I had no money, so I couldn't ride anything, I couldn't buy anything, I couldn't do anything. Well, one of my friends had said that he had heard a story that the man who runs the concessions at the grandstands would hire random kids to sell the concessions in the grandstands during the programs and things like that and give you money. so that you could go and ride rides and go to the Midway and buy food. So the next day, we rode our bikes and parked them down at the stables. We went up to the grandstands. We found the concession guy, and sure enough, it was true. First come, first serve. Like the first five or six kids that he got to say yes, he would put them to work. And so that day, the first thing that was on the ballot in the grandstands was an 11 o'clock tractor pull. And for that tractor pull, we had to go through the grandstands, and we had to sell Coke, cotton candy, peanuts, popcorn, you know, walk around going, peanuts, popcorn, Coke here, you know, and sell those things. And then once you got done, you'd go back and fill up your tray and go back up into the grandstands again. And once the tractor pull was over, you came back down. The concession guy had kept track of how much you sold. He gave you your cut, and then you headed out to the Midway. And so we got handed a whole bunch of money, and we went out and we said, now we can spend the rest of the day riding and eating and drinking and having a whole bunch of fun. So we rode our bikes home on that next day, and we said, this is awesome. We've got a plan for the week. So the following day we came back, we went right up to the concession guy, and the concession guy said, sure, first come, first serve, gave us all jobs again. Well, this day there was a musical group that was going to be performing. There was a concert. And so we were getting things ready, and one of the other guys that was working the concessions, who had worked the concessions before, he was older, he was probably 14. And he came up and he said, hey, the way that we make money on concerts is that we go backstage and we ask the band if they want anything. And then we go get it for them. And when we bring it back, they give us a big tip. So do you want to go back with me and see if the band wants anything? And I'm like, sure, that sounds great. So we go around the back of the grandstands and go down the side, and we come back around the back of the stage, and there's like the bus, and there's a truck, and then there's two guys sitting outside of this, like, looks like a bus slash RV. One guy's playing a guitar, the other guy's playing a harmonica. And so we go up to him and we said, excuse me, sir, are you with the band? And they said, yes, we're with the band. And we said, hey, we would be happy to go get you something. Do you want anything from the Midway? You want something to eat? You want something to drink? We'd be happy to go get it for you. And the guy playing the guitar looked and he said, you know, I'd like some ribs. Are there good ribs here? And of course, I had no idea because I didn't eat ribs, but we're like, yeah, there's great ribs here. And so he handed us money. We ran down on the Midway, went to the big tent where they got all the ribs and got all the ribs that we could buy with the money, came back and gave them the ribs, and they gave us this beautiful tip, this huge tip. The tip was so big that we didn't even work the grandstands for the concert because we didn't need to, because we just made enough money to afford the rest of the day. And it was wonderful. And we went out and we rode the rides and we ate food and we drank drinks, and it was just awesome. Our first story tonight, by the way, you got to figure out which one is the lie. First story tonight is Nate Dean Jessup. That was an inside joke because, what was it, the second week, Darlene, you thought his name was Nate and you were just calling him Nate the whole time. So we've just been calling him Nate Dean Jessup from this whole time. And for each one of the storytellers tonight, I have asked them a random question, and they've given me their answers as part of their introduction. So the random question was, what's the best piece of advice you've ever been given? And Nate Dean Jessup said, always keep an open mind. Ladies and gentlemen, Dean Jessup.
This extra right here.
That's the extra.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. The name of my story is Hope Jaded and Hope Restored. For 26 years of my life, I was a legal investigator. I did the kind of cases that I built lawsuits with personal injuries, will contests, bank fraud, a number of those kind of things on the civil side. On the criminal side, I did criminal defense. I've done rape cases, child molest cases, even a couple of homicides, if you will. As you might well imagine, there were a few people along the way who were not people you really want to sit across the table from. But one of my mentors early on, when I was first learning how to do the craft, was told me one time, he said, there's three things, son, in this business that you can always count on. Every case that you investigate is going to be caused by one of three things or a combination of all three. And those three things are power, greed, and sex. One or all three of those is going to be involved in every case you investigate. And he was absolutely 100% right, I found in 26 years. But as I said, a few of those people that I came in contact with on a regular basis were less than desirable, but the most often confronted of those three axioms was greed. Whenever you build lawsuits for a living, you're going to get somebody that always thinks that that bruise they got on their arm was worth $150,000. When you'd be lucky if you get the insurance company to give you a nuisance value. That being said, I've had people sit across the table from me and tell me it takes a lot of money to keep me happy. Well, we kind of knew what they were there for. I've had worked a will contest one time where a 50-year-old married woman lay in bed with an 85-year-old man to convince him to change the will so that her and her husband got his farm when he died. It's very easy to see how after a daily dose of this kind of stuff, one might get cynical and jaded, and I had. And then, October 20th, 1987, one of the biggest cases I ever had came across my desk, and a gentleman that was Major Bruce Teagarden of the United States Air Force had been to, he was based in Nellis Air Base in Nevada. He had been to Pittsburgh to attend the funeral of a colleague, and since he had to get a certain number of hours every month in flying an A7 Corsair to stay certified, he used the A7 to go to Pittsburgh. He attended the funeral and was on his way back to Nellis, and he had just passed Indianapolis International air traffic and was about halfway between Indianapolis and Terre Haute. And at 9:11 in the morning, that number ring a bell to anybody? At 9:11 in the morning, he radioed Indianapolis Air Traffic Control and informed them that he had lost an engine and tried to restart and it wouldn't. So he was going to turn the plane around and try to get back to Indianapolis International. The unfortunate part about the A7 Corsair, it was a Vietnam-era jet. But the unfortunate part about it is it had the glide ratio of a rock. So it wasn't going to glide back to Indy very easily. When he saw that it looked like he was not going to make the runway, he radioed air traffic control and said, please steer me away from residence. They never responded. And at the last moment, he hit the ejection button. And he and his parachute landed across the street in the front parking lot or front lot of a bank across the street from the airport. The A7 landed in the lobby of the Ramada Inn, killing 9 people instantly, and the 10th one died the next day. Mary Marsh was by far the largest case that we had. We had the law firm I worked for at the time represented 7 of the 9 people killed that first morning. And Mary Marsh was by far the largest case. Mary was a 29-year-old mother of 2 on her second marriage. The children were by her first marriage. And by all accounts, Mary was the kind of person when she walked in a room, it just lit up. And she was very good at her job, and everybody just dearly loved Mary. Mary's office was adjacent to the front desk, and she was killed instantly. Well, If you've ever worked a case against the United States government, then you know that there's just going to be a whole lot of hoops to jump through. So it took us a while to get this case on down the road into a settlement posture. And part of what I was assigned immediately to do was collect evidence, document evidence, and chains of custody and so forth. One of the law clerks was assigned the duty of jurisdiction. And why was that important? Because five of those seven people that we represented in Indiana were worth nothing because they weren't married and they didn't have any dependents. So we were looking for a jurisdiction where we could get damages for those families too. 2 weeks after we took the case, the law clerk came into my office and he said, "I've got it." I said, "Okay, what have you got?" He said, "Track with me. The only thing that the plane did in Indiana was fall out of the sky. The negligent maintenance took place in Nevada and Oklahoma, and it was 900 hours over on a PM inspection." 900 hours is quite a ways. Anyway, I said, "Okay, that tells me why you want to put it there, but tell me why we want to go there." And he said, "Because in Nevada, you can get damages for disfigurement of a corpse," which is his way of saying the laws are much more liberal there and we might be able to get something for those five people. We did end up filing in Las Vegas, Nevada, and the judge wanted to apply Indiana law, which was just going to make it difficult for us, but eventually he relented and we were able to get something for those five families, and I'm proud to say that all five families set up scholarship funds in their decedents' names. It wasn't a matter of we want the money to go do something fun with. That brings us to months down the road when we finally have jumped through all the hoops and we've got the case in a settlement posture. We're now at what is known as the distribution meeting, and I've attended several of these, and usually that frequent flyer that I get all the time with greed, this is usually where that really pops its head up. In this meeting was the attorney, the client, a paralegal, and myself. And the attorney started the meeting by saying, "As the widower, you're entitled to 50% of this recovery." Now keep in mind, the children weren't there because they were too young. And as soon as he got those words out of his mouth, the client went, "Stop. Let me tell you what I want." And my thought was, uh-oh, here it goes. This is going to get ugly. He said, "I want you to pay off the house. I want you to pay off Mary's car. I want you to pay off the credit cards that Mary and I had together, and every penny beyond that goes to those kids." There wasn't a dry eye in the house. And for a little while, my hope was restored. And it got even more so when a couple years down the road, the client came in with the kids to tell us thank you. And what made it even better was they didn't call him by his name. They called him Dad.
Next up, we have Darlene Hobaugh. And Darlene, her best piece of advice that she's ever received is follow your heart. Darlene.
Hello. Well, the name of my story is Life is Eternal. Believe it or not. I have been blessed with many, many, many very interesting family members. But for this story, I chose my mother's youngest brother, Roy. Uncle Roy was a very handsome man. He had a wonderful personality. He had a very good voice, much like Frank Sinatra's, and he was always singing. He had a song for every occasion. He was always singing. The first time I really remember seeing Uncle Roy was when I was 4 years old, and it was Christmas morning, and I woke up before dawn, and I heard him singing Christmas carols in the living room. As I got older, I saw him very often with his best friend, John. They were like two peas in a pod, always together. And then by the time I was a teenager, Uncle Roy was married with children of his own. Uncle John was married to my mother's and my Uncle Roy's youngest sister, June. So then I had two uncles. And they also had children. Well, we were always together as family for every opportunity, holiday, something special. The family was always together. But there were times when my Uncle Roy would come to Pittsburgh City without his family, and at those times he would stay at our house. We always loved it when he came for a visit. My mother always had music on of some kind, so he could always be singing, and she loved harmonizing with him. And we children really enjoyed it because he was great at playing tricks on everybody and pranks. And some of the pranks that he played, I have handed down to my grandchildren, and I'm sure they'll hand them down to their grandchildren. At any rate, it was wonderful having him there. By the time I was older and I got married and had children, my Uncle Roy had gotten divorced and my Aunt June and Uncle John had moved to Missouri. One after another, it seemed like the family followed and started to move to Missouri, and by the time my children were a little older, like in high school, and one was in college, we also moved to Missouri, so the whole family was living at Lake St. Louis. Well, Uncle Roy was living with Uncle John then, so it was really good for my children because they got to know him with all his jokes, his singing, and his pranks. He helped teach my daughters how to drive. He taught my son how to take care of the boats and to drive the boats. And he was somebody that everybody could always talk to, so they had another person that they could talk to also. We had a very good time together. But then he got cancer. And once he got cancer, things started to calm down as far as the music went. The whole family helped him, did as much as they could for him. But I was only working part-time, so I became an integral part of his life, his daily life. I was with him almost every day. When it got so bad that he couldn't take care of himself much anymore, it was my husband that had to pick him up and carry him to the car because he was so frail. And after he was in the hospital, it was right around that time that my oldest daughter, Tasha, had come home for a college break. And she was anxious to see him. We were all going to see him, so we hurried to the hospital, and she got out of the car and ran ahead of everybody, and she went up to his room, and by the time we were all getting off of the elevator, she was coming out of his room, and she was like, they moved him. He's not there anymore. There's only an old man, bald man in there, and he looks like he just got released from a concentration camp. It was heartbreaking to hear my son have to explain to her that no, that indeed was Uncle Roy. We had a short visit. Everybody went home but me, because my grandmother and I had made a plan. She was still in Pittsburgh. All of his children were still in Pittsburgh. So we had made a plan that they would all get together and they would call him at a certain time that night so that I was there to hold the phone for him and he could speak with all of them. After they called, he was very much more at peace and seemed to be resting, and I was ready to leave. But he got enough strength that even though he wasn't really doing much for himself at all, he lifted his hand and he pointed to a crucifix that was on the wall across from his bed. And he said, "That's the way. That's the only way." Well, when I left that night, he died. Nobody in the family ever got to see him again because he had given his body to research. Now you have to jump ahead many months. Now both of my girls were in college. My son was in high school. Ron was out on the road working. It was a normal morning. My son left. I went in, sat down on the side of my bed, and I guess I was planning what I was going to do with the day. I don't really remember. But the light in the room started to change. And as it changed and changed, boom, Uncle Roy was standing right in front of me. I was like, "Oh my God, Uncle Roy, what are you doing here?" He was beautiful. He looked like he was in his 30s. He had a full head of hair. He was well-dressed. He was smiling. He just looked so good. He smiled and he says to me, "Well, I appreciate everything that you ever did for me. And I know how you believe and feel, but I have one more favor to ask of you." And I'm like, "Okay." So he says, "I want you to tell Mom," my grandmother, "that I'm at peace and I have no more pain." I said, "Okay. Well, what's it like there?" And he said, "Very much like where you are, except we're not inhibited by our bodies." And I said, "Are you gonna come back?" And he's like, "No, I don't think that'll be necessary." So he turns and he starts to walk toward my bedroom door. But then he pauses and he looks at me over his left shoulder, still smiling, and he says, "Oh, one more thing. Tell Mom I'm singing again." I was just like in shock. I ran out of the room. I called my pastor. I blabbed on and on. Was I crazy? Was I nuts? What was going on? And I was assured that everything was fine, that lots of other people had seen and gone through the same thing. The only thing he told me to do was what he had asked. So I immediately went and I wrote a letter to my grandmother explaining everything. And then I wrote one to Uncle Roy's oldest daughter, Petty, and explained everything there, and I mailed it. Well, unbeknownst to me, when my letter arrived at my grandmother's house in Pittsburgh, my cousin Penny was there to pick her up and take her to Rome, Pennsylvania for a week or two on a vacation. So my grandma just put the letter in her purse and they went off. But when they got to Penny's house, the letter was there. So my grandma and Penny got to sit down at the kitchen table, read the letters together. Immediately, Guy got a phone call. Penny was first. She was so thankful Uncle Roy came to me because she said she couldn't have handled it. She doesn't know what she would have done. Then my grandmother got on. She didn't feel the same. She said, "No, he should have come to see me. I'm the one that wanted to see him." As for me, I know that life is eternal. And Life is eternal, and you can believe it or not. Thank you.
And I apologize in advance for butchering the last name, Lorette Vacchiano. Now, you said there's an Italian way to pronounce it. Is it? Okay. And now, how's the American way to pronounce it?
Vacchiano.
Vacchiano. We like the ch. Vacchiano. So, the best piece of advice that Lorette has ever received is, don't rescue your kids. Welcome.
Good evening. The title of my story is Love Never Dies. About 2.5 years ago, I woke up one morning with severely pinched nerves and a great deal of pain, and that subsequently started the issues with my back, herniated discs and osteoarthritis and hip spurs and on and on and on. Anyway, still had a lot of pain, even with all the doctors and the physical therapy and so forth. And in talking with a friend of mine, she suggested that I go to see an acupuncturist. And I had never been to one. I had no idea whether that was going to help me or not, but I was open to it. So I went to the acupuncturist, and in the office, in the ladies' restroom of all places, is a framed print that says, Love Never Dies. And this was situated, like if you're on the toilet, it's right there. I mean, it was just, and I knew it was there for me to see. I knew that. And I kept staring at it, and I thought, what does this mean? What is this trying to tell me? I contemplated the things in my life, like how can I relate this to my life? So I immediately thought of, this is going to sound bad, but it has a happy ending. 4 years ago, my son died from an overdose, a drug overdose. He was 31. His name is Joe. And I related what that print said to his death. So 4 years ago, I'll never forget, my husband and I were in the back of the house watching the Eagles game, and the doorbell rang. And as I approached the front of the house through the windows, I could see two police cars. And so I knew exactly what that meant. A parent's greatest fear of anyone who is living with addiction is that you'll get the phone call in the middle of the night or the knock at your door telling you that your loved one has passed. So that was my greatest fear, and it did come true. I knew that I did everything I could as a mother to help my son learn about addiction and how to cope with it and on, Narcotics Anonymous and so meetings and so forth. And I also educated myself about that as well. I was very angry after this happened. I was really, really angry and very bitter. And I wanted nothing to do with God. I completely washed myself clean of any kind of faith. So I was just very, like I said, very bitter, very angry. I would look at other people with their children, with their sons and daughters, with their grandchildren, and I would be like, God, how could you do this to me? He was my only son. I do have a daughter. We were very close. Two peas in a pod. Why? You know, why did this happen? Why did it have to be me? So over time, rather than going to counseling, which I regret now, over time, there were two things that came to mind to help me with what I thought would help me cope with this. One was, I begged my husband to go to Florida to live there full time because I felt that it would be a new start for me, a new beginning. Everything would be different. I wouldn't have to live with the memories in Pennsylvania, with Joe's friends, just the places he would frequent, and so on. So he agreed, and I was very thankful for that. There's something to be said for waking up to sunshine every day, especially when you have depression. It gives you energy, it gives you motivation. Well, over time, unfortunately, after the novelty of living in Florida, I still struggled a great, great deal with depression and anxiety. So the second thing I thought of was, okay, I was a school teacher for 30 years, but my passion was ballroom and Latin dancing, which I had done for about 20 years. So I thought, I know what I'll do. I'm going to throw myself into my dancing. I danced like 5 to 6 times a week between lessons and social dancing. And I thought, that's going to cure this depression. The endorphins will start to be released, and you know, you're going to just be just fine. You're going to cope. Well, sure. I mean, that lasted for a while, but it was not a permanent cure. After those endorphins stopped running through my body, I was still the same depressed, anxious person. And so each week when I would go to the acupuncturist and see that sign, love never dies, I started thinking, you know, Lorette, you need help with this. And I knew in my heart that to be angry at the Lord didn't sit right with me. It did at the time because I was so emotional and I was just so angry. But I knew in my heart that I had to get back to the Lord. So I started to pray and I started to read the Bible and started to have the relationship with the Lord that I have now, which is probably the best relationship I've ever had with him. And I pleaded with him. I said, please, dear God, help me to get through this. I can't do it without you. And so thoughts were popping into my mind that I was looking at my son's death all wrong. That instead of dwelling on all the negative, he died alone, which really still bothers me a lot. I never really got to say goodbye to him because he went missing for 5 days. It was just all the negative, you know, all the bad things about it. So the thought was like, okay, you're thinking about this all wrong. You need to turn it over and think about the positive love that you have for your son and the love that he had for you. And I thought, you know what? That makes sense. And then it brought me back to the picture, you know, the frame of the picture that says, love never dies. And that's exactly right. I mean, I felt more, even though I still cry when I talk about my son, you never really get over it. But I think about it in a different way now. I think about all the positive things about him and the years that I had with him. He was a good kid. He went to school. He went to college. He had jobs. Everyone liked him. He was really fun and had a great sense of humor. So now I realize, you know, I carry that with me in my heart, and I don't go to that dark place anymore. And my life has really flourished as a result. And I like in my experience, too, that of a caterpillar. And a caterpillar goes into the little cocoon, the chrysalis. And that's kind of like when I went into, you know, my period when I didn't want anything to do with God or my faith. But worked through that, evolved, the chrysalis opens up, and what evolves is a butterfly. And now I feel like I'm a butterfly. I've gone through this transition in my life, and I'm so much better for it. And so the point of my story is love never dies.
Well, last but certainly not least is Drenna Rosenthal. And Drenna and I go way back because Drenna was a part of First Christian when I was there. She wrote plays that my little girls were a part of. And so it's been a blessing to have Drenna with us for this storytelling class. Drenna's best piece of advice that she's ever been given, don't say the word can't. Drenna Rosenthal.
I don't trust my knees. I was raised on a ranch way, way out in West Texas. And to give you an example about way, way out it was, we were 300 miles west of Fort Worth, Dallas, 300 miles north of San Antonio, and 500 miles east of El Paso, way, way out there. There weren't very many people there. There were a lot of tumbleweeds, prickly pear cactus, lots of jackrabbits, lots of rattlesnakes. I was way out on this ranch. I really didn't have anybody to play with. I had a little pink mare named Tiny, had a dog, had a pet goat. Those were my playmates. The only time I got to see any children was when I went to church. And my mother was Church of Christ. So we were at church on Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night, always, always. I met a little girl there. Her name was Patsy. And Patsy was wonderful. She was almost six, just like I was. So we would play. We got in lots of trouble in Sunday school because we would leave up and the teacher would separate us, and we would still sit across the table and deal. So one Sunday, my mother and Patsy's mother had arranged for Patsy, and her older sister, Mary, to come home with us to play. I was so excited. I couldn't sleep, couldn't eat. All I thought about was Patsy, so we'd be there. So we drove home, which was about 20 miles away from the little town. And speaking of little town, Sheffield had a post office, a filling station, a Church of Christ and a Baptist church, and a feed store. No houses there because everybody lived on ranches around there. So we got to the ranch, we ran past, changed our clothes, and ate fast so we could go out and play. My daddy had sat on my horse, so we rode Tiny, and we rode down by the windmill. And the windmill wasn't a real tall one. So we climbed up on the windmill, and we were sitting up there talking. When you are on top of a windmill, you are the queen of the world. We looked out around the ranch. Our house sat right at the foot of a hill, and right behind the house was a huge water storage tank that went up the hill. So the side of that water tank that was toward the house was very, very steep, and the water was deep. And around the other side, it was short, so you could get on it. But we decided to play hide and seek. We knew we could hide in the barn, but I told the girls, don't go near the water tank, because my mother had forbidden me to go near that tank. I didn't know how to swim, and I was afraid of the water. So we got down and started playing hide and seek. Mary hid, I was it, so I found her. And then Mary was it, and Patsy and I went to hide. I went down in the barn where my dad was shooting a horse and hid down there. But Mary found me really quick. So then we both started to look for Patsy. Couldn't find her. We came out and called and called and called. About that time, we heard Patsy say, hey, I won. I won. And we looked up, and there she was, walking around the edge of that water tank. Patsy started, Mary started screaming at her, "Get down, get down." And we both started running up to the tank. My mother heard us yelling, and she came out. And about that time, Patsy fell into the water. Well, my mother was a very, very short woman, not very big. And she got into the tank and tried to get Patsy out. She was able to get her up to the side, but couldn't get her out. My daddy, who had been down the barn, came running as fast as he could. And he got up to the tank, got Patsy out, laid her down on the ground, and started to do CPR. When I think about this story, I have no idea how my daddy learned to do CPR, but he did. He wasn't able to revive her, although he worked and worked. And then he just sat back on his heels and told my mother, "Go get a blanket. We have to take Patsy home." I can't remember very much about that part of it. I remember in the car, no one said a word. Everybody was silent, and my mother was just crying. We got to the house, and of course, her parents were very, very distraught. I don't remember anything about the funeral, but I've heard my mother tell that the little church of Christ was filled. Every seat was taken in that church, and there were people on the edges. She also told us about how there were so many flowers in the church. How they got there, I don't have any idea, because we sure didn't have flowers in Sheffield. I will never forget this day. It's burned into my memory, but I didn't realize what a lesson in forgiveness those parents' reaction was. And so one day I was going through this box of my mother's memoirs. In it, she had lots of pictures, of course, and cards that she had kept that people had sent her, even my report cards. And in that box, I found a card. This was from Patsy's mother. "Dear Evan and Elvin, you were so sweet to us in the loss of our precious baby. And I don't want you to think that we blame you. I could not be a Christian and blame you, because I know if you could have saved her, you would. We appreciate what you did. It was a terrible shock, and I may have said something to hurt you, but if I did, I sincerely apologize. We love you both dearly." I think about that. I think if somebody brought my child home wrapped in a blanket, I don't know if I could forgive them. Could you?
Lake County Fair, 13, riding my bike a half hour, parking it at the stables, spending all my money on the first day, selling concessions at the grandstand, going backstage and getting a special order from a musical person with a big tip. Which part's the lie? Pardon me?
Big tip.
Ding, 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 ding. Big tip. Everything was exactly true all the way up to the big tip, all the way up to the point where the guy came to me and he said, "Hey, this musical group, what you do is you go backstage and you ask them," and I was too scared at the age of 13 to do that. Too scared at all. Well, here's the funny thing about it. He wasn't, and he went back and got the ribs, and he got the big tip, and he spent the rest of the day on the Midway, and he told me all about it. He told me all about the day that he sold B.B. King ribs. For many, many, many years, I told that story, inserting myself into selling B.B. King ribs. And it wasn't until one day when I was telling the story and the words were coming out of my mouth that I said to myself, "You're lying. You didn't have the guts to go back and sell B.B. King ribs," even though I wouldn't have known who B.B. King was when at 13, but I didn't have the guts to do it. And I share that with you because sometimes we will tell a lie, even if it's a little one, enough that it will become our truth. And we've got to constantly examine that. I hope that this has been enjoyable for you. I know it's been a blessing for me over the last 2 months to spend the time with this group and to watch them process and create stories and to listen to the stories tonight based on what I remember them sounding like several weeks ago when they did their first run through. Totally different. And it's been such a blessing. So thank you for allowing me to be a part of your lives. And thank you for having the guts to stand up here and share it with other people. Because I know there were some people, Darlene, that on that first day, when I announced that this was going to be happening, that they literally went running for the door. We had to lock it to keep her in. But thank you for being a part of it. And as the little note says on there, I believe it's January 17th will be our next semester of Small Group University. We'll be having at least two classes, I'm sure. And we don't know what those classes are yet because we're still working on that. But also, too, before we go, I want to recognize Tom Matthews, who's here tonight, because Tom was the one that was the leader of the other class, and that was the characters of the New Testament. And so, Tom, again, sorry for all those nights we had to leave our door open, because those of you who have been in Fellowship Hall, we have three rooms back in the back of the Fellowship Hall. Well, the thermostat's in one room. So by the one room gets really cold, the second room gets cold, the third room, it doesn't get there, because by the time it gets cold there, it's not cold down there. So we had to crank the air conditioning way up. So he was, one, freezing, which he's crazy. He likes freezing anyway. So he was cold. And we had to leave the door open, so he was hearing a guffawing and our conversations. But Tom, thank you so much for teaching and jumping in at the last minute this semester. I appreciate that. And I look forward to what this next semester is going to hold. So, thank you for coming out tonight and being a part of our first Storytellers Night. And thank you for you four people who had the guts to tell your stories. Let's have a word of prayer. Oh, gracious Lord, we are a people of a story. We study the story of creation. We study the story of redemption. We study the story of salvation. But also, too, Lord, we live the story of creation. We live the story of redemption. We live the story of salvation. And I want to thank you tonight for these five little glimpses into that story. And Lord, I pray that for each and every single one of us, there was something here that connected. There was something here that made us think. For Lord, that's why we are storytellers, because it helps us to process. It helps us to think. So as we leave this place, keep us safe. And as we leave this place, remind us to always tell our stories. We pray it in the name of Jesus. Amen. And a big round of applause for all the storytellers.
Where are you recording?